Hey, Art, here is a true story about my cousin and her son. At the time, my cousin's bedroom was upstairs while the son's was in the basement. One night, the son was having a dream during which he walked upstairs, entered his parents' bedroom, saw his parents covered in blood, and when he looked down, a gun was in his hands. At the very same time, my cousin was having a dream in which she dreamed her son was coming in her bedroom and shooting her and her husband. That dream scared her so badly, she woke up, headed down the stairs to her son. Guess what? She met him coming up the stairs, no gun in his hands, but both were scared and fell down crying in each other's arms. A gun was kept upstairs, and the son knew where it was. Was something driving him toward the gun? Was something protecting the family? Your guess is as good as mine. Dennis in Kansas City, can you imagine that? A mother and a son having an identical dream of murder that came that close to consummating. You tell me what that is. West of the Rockies, you're on the air. Hi.
Hi, I'm calling from Wenatchee.
Well, welcome.
Washington?
Yes.
I was asleep one night, and I was having a nightmare that somebody was trying to kill me. And I tried to wake up because I knew I was dreaming. But mm-hmm. And then all of a sudden, I felt like somebody had just put their knee or pressure on the bed.
Oh.
And that just scared me so bad, and I was struggling really, really hard to wake up. And I finally was able to open my eyes, and there was no one on the side of the bed, but at the foot of the bed was, I could see a man from the waist up, but he was in light. It was like, it was a negative, where it should be light, it was
dark.
Where it was light, it was really bright.
I've got you.
And he was moving around. I could see the outline of his face and his features and all that. And he was moving around doing stuff. And all I could do was just, I kept saying, I don't want to know. I don't want to know. I don't want to know. And I looked over, and I had turned on my light, and I looked at my clock, and I looked back, and he was still there.
That's bad.
I know. And I went to sleep. I was hoping I would forget it, and I have never been able to forget it, but I don't know what it was.
Well, how long did he remain? At some point, he had to go away, right?
Yeah, it was, I don't know, several minutes.
You know what?
What?
You're lucky you weren't attacked.
I know.
Because that's what it may have been.
Well, do you know what happened, though, then about 5 months later? Because this happened last year. And then about 5 months later, I was sitting here in my dining room with my back to the sliding window.
Uh-huh.
And I kept thinking I was hearing something outside. And I sit here with my door open a little bit to blow the smoke out. And I got up to get a cup of coffee. And I went over and I sat back down. And all of a sudden, I just thought, oh, my God, I knew somebody was behind me.
Mm-hmm.
And I was just terrified. I got up and I went to get another cup of coffee, you know. And I thought, I guess I better replace the lights on my patio. And I went out to my laundry room, which is right next to the slider,
yeah,
to get a light bulb. And when I reached over to turn on the light, there was a man there.
Oh, bad.
He had been within 5 feet of me. And the police came and they found his footprints all around my house. And I kept thinking, well, maybe it was just, maybe it was lucky. I don't know.
I appreciate the call. Thank you. Yes, creepy in both circumstances. First time caller line, you're on the air. Hi.
Good morning, Spell.
Good morning.
Well, this story goes back about 15 years ago up in Washington State. I was living in a real nice cabin up above a lake. It was an old cabin built in the early 1900s. And I'm a jeweler by trade, and I do a lot of work late at night. I'm a late night hawker. I kept feeling something over my shoulder,
uh-huh,
and my wife would be up in bed. One night, I turned around real quick, and I said, damn it, leave me alone. And nothing happened. And I didn't feel it anymore. Well, I talked to my wife about it, and I have had encounters before. I says, you know, this thing ain't going to hurt me, or I would have done it. So that night, late, and I'm working away, and I says, hey, listen, whatever, whoever you are, I'm sorry. I didn't mean to hurt your feelings. Come back.
Huh.
About an hour later, I feel something over my shoulder.
Yes.
Kiddingly, I started nicknaming him Henry.
Yes.
A week, 2 weeks goes by, and my wife's sitting there, and I say something about Henry, and a voice comes up, and it says, my name's not Henry, it's Harry.
Harry.
Time goes by, and we start communicating.
Wait, slow up.
Yeah.
He said his name was Harry.
He said his name was Harry.
Now, was this out loud?
No.
You heard this in your mind?
Exactly. But it's together. We both hear this.
That's bad.
And I'm speaking out loud to him.
Yes. And he's answering in your head.
Yeah.
And your
exactly.
wife.
Exactly.
Great.
So I'm talking away, and I actually through time. This is over weeks, maybe even a couple months, and I feel him every night on my shoulder watching me. One night he says to me, tell your wife I'm sorry. I didn't mean to scare her. I will not do it again.
Okay.
The next day, of course, I wake up late. The next day, she says, your buddy visited me last night and scared the hell out of me. And I says, what are you talking about?
Yes.
She says, Henry was looking over me in my bed. And she says, I hollered at him and told him to get out of my room and never to come back again. I got the wickedest feeling. I looked at her and I says, that's what he meant. She says, what? I says, he told me to tell you he was sorry and it would never happen again.
Yeah.
Now, through time, I tried to communicate with him and find out. I did not do any research on it, Art. I guess, scared to find out what I might find out.
Sure. Is that when he disappeared?
He never did. We moved out of the place, but he communicated with us until the time we moved. And he told me he was killed in a fire in the home. I said, well, where was this fire supposed to be?
And you never researched it?
Well, I found where the fire was.
You did?
I found where the fire was. He told me where the fire had been and how I could find boards. And I went to the far end of the house.
Mm-hmm.
This room was, the front room was very, very big. It was very beautiful. Now, like I say, this was an old house, but it was still beautiful, and it had been redone. I went to the far end of the room where the stairs start going upstairs.
Yes.
I removed a board, and there was burnt, charcoaled lumber underneath it.
Oh, man.
And that's really all there is to it. He never meant to hurt anybody.
That's
enough. He was neat.
Well, your idea of neat... I very much appreciate your call, sir, but I don't know that that's my idea of neat. That's more than a coincidence. I guess if it happened to you and it didn't come to you in a frightening form, it would be, his word, neat. But I think I would have to experience that calm and that lack of concern and worry personally before I would regard it as neat. Burning is not a good way to go. First time caller line, you're on the air. Hi.
Hi. I'm calling from Kelso, Montana. Several years ago, we lived on a ranch, and we had a great big old house. It looked like almost like a plantation. We had a long pillars and everything, and it was kind of scary. One night...
Like an old southern plantation
house.
Yeah,
it did. Yeah. It had, you know, the top had like five bedrooms.
Oh, I know. I've lived in a house like that.
It had
yes.
an old wood stove. You know, we had to chop wood for it and everything. And,
yes.
And really liked it, but it was spooky. One night, my mother had to leave, and she was going to be gone overnight. I had a girlfriend come stay with me.
Mm-hmm.
And we stayed up and watched TV till it was no more television, and we went upstairs. I had my bedroom upstairs, and it was a nice evening. It was summer, and it was moonlit night, and we're talking and laughing and telling stories, as girls will. And all of a sudden, I heard something outside, and I there was an old tree had grown there, and it was real close to my window, some of the limbs, and I thought, well, the wind must have come up, it's knocking against that window, and we looked, and it wasn't. And I kept listening and listening, and I thought, well, that is a very familiar sound. And she says, well, what is it? And I said, oh, my God, it sounds like somebody's chopping wood. We had a wood pile right outside the
sure.
house there on the back
sure.
by close to the back porch. And I chopped a lot of wood, but I knew what that sound was.
You bet.
And we just looked at each other. We were just, like, horrified. And I thought, well, we've got to go see what this is, you know. So we went downstairs, and I think she had a baseball bat, and I probably had a butter knife or something. And we walked outside this old porch and got to the end of it. And there was a very large, about a 500-gallon propane tank, a white one, at the end of this porch.
Oh, yes.
The sound is still continuing, only it's loud. And it's definitely something, just chopping wood. And I'm going, oh, my God, you know. And so we were too scared to step off the porch and look around the house. And all of a sudden, the noise stopped. And we're just, like, frozen right there. And I looked over. We're looking towards the propane tank. The moon is just right. And all of a sudden, there's this long, dark shadow. And it's floating. And it's in the shape like of a person. It had a head and shoulders. It looked like a man's shadow, a very tall one. And it's floating across that propane tank towards us.
Bad.
And we screamed and ran to the door, and I grabbed the door, and she would shove me out of the way, and she'd grab the door, and we were out there like 5 minutes just trying to get in the house. We finally got in. We stayed awake all night. I was so scared. The next day we went out, and there was wood had been chopped, and it was thrown all over the barnyard and all over the yard, and it was, I wish they'd have stacked it. That would have been nice.
Whatever in the hell was out there, it wasn't good.
No, it wasn't, and it was just, I never stayed there alone again without my mother there anyway. So, you know, I'm glad we, you know, didn't go any further than the end of that porch. And, but we were just terrified. I just, you know, stayed completely, I don't think we even went outside till, you know, the sun was completely up and it
yep.
was warm. And
these things impress you for all your life, don't
yes,
they?
Yes, it did. I still remember it. I can just almost see this, you know.
You
I
mean. Never, ever forget. Wildcard Line, you're on the air. Hi.
Hi, this is Ron from Bartlesville, Oklahoma.
Hello, Ron.
I have a story about my daughter.
All right.
Okay, when she was about 4 years old, we moved to the Kansas City area and bought an old two-story house there. Shortly after moving in, the neighbor's house was broken into, and the police later came and asked if we had heard or seen anything.
Uh-huh.
After they left, my daughter said, Daddy, my friend Daggett said he would never let bad people in our house.
Huh.
And I asked her who Daggett was.
Yes.
You know, I am from California originally. I know there's a Daggett, California.
Yes, there is.
And she had never been to California at that time, and I don't know where she came up with that name. So anyway, I asked her,
who's Daggett?
Who's Daggett?
Yep.
She said that he lived in the house, and he'd been there for a long time. Well, my wife and I just wrote that off, you know, childhood imagination.
Imaginary playmate.
Right. Well, anyway, we lived there about 4 years, and we constantly heard things, especially in the basement. Our washer and dryer were in the basement, and it got to where my wife wouldn't go down into the basement unless I was in the house, and then at night she wouldn't even go down at all unless I went with her, so
I don't
just got
her.
To where I did the laundry.
Right.
It may have been a trick on her part. Huh?
A trick?
Anyway, my daughter would occasionally run to the basement stairs and yell, be quiet, Daggett, and the noise would stop. Well, anyway, this was, like I say, just written off as, you know, an old house that creaked in a child's imagination.
Sure.
But one night, I went into her bedroom to read her bedtime story, and we had a large, overstuffed chair sitting next to her bed.
Uh-huh.
And I sat down in the chair, and it was like I had walked into a meat locker. I mean, it was so cold that it took my breath away.
Uh-huh.
And my daughter screamed, Daddy, get off of Daggett.
Oh, my.
And from that point on...
How old is your daughter now?
Well, I'm... Like Paul Harvey says, this is the rest of the story.
All right.
My daughter is a freshman at a university here in Oklahoma that I won't give you the name of or the identifier, but anyway, she is president of the university's pagan society. So she's a witch. She is a member or whatever you call it of the group called Wicca.
Yes, those are witches.
So she is all excited right now. She just called me about an hour ago. You know, the big goings on. You know, that they're having a big overnight bonfire. And
oh, I'm sure it's a big day.
I don't.
It's a big day.
I don't even ask questions about what's going on.